Wynton Marsalis I first met in 1986. At the time, his most recent recording was J Mood. And so I learned all of the music from that album, as I had all of his other albums. He invited me to come sit in with his band a couple of nights later at the Academy of Music. At that point, I decided that I want to play jazz for a living. The music is so deeply entrenched in my family, not just my dad, but also my great uncle, Howard Cooper, and my mother's brother, Tony McBride, who was a promotions man at WHAT Radio. So as far back as I can remember, I was going to see live shows. My mother tells me my first live concert was Marvin Gaye at the Spectrum in 74, but I was too young to remember it. But she says it must be buried in there somewhere. When I started playing the electric bass at 9, the music that I was learning on the bass was popular music. First song I ever learned how to play was Papa Was a Rolling Stone, and then it went on from there. I would just listen to the radio, and I would listen to my mother's albums, and I was just trying to pick out the bass line from every song that I heard. You know, I didn't realize it then, but I was giving myself ear training. Once my mother saw that I was really getting serious about this, that's when she decided it was time for me to go to a school that had a good music program. And then that's when I went to Pepper Middle School and started studying the acoustic bass. I was always deeply into popular music. As a kid, just like everybody else, I loved Michael Jackson, I loved Prince, I loved Rick James. But because of all of the history in my family, James Brown was my number one hero. I was the only 7-year-old in elementary school. You know, this would have been 1979. Everybody else was listening to Off the Wall, which I listened to also. But then I had, like, you know, I was listening to my uncle's, you know, Payback album and Live at the Apollo. And I would come to school talking about these records. You know, all my friends was just like, man, James Brown, man, that's that old music. You know, I was like, man, you guys don't know what you're talking about. I got to first play with James Brown in 1997. He invited me to sit in with his band at his birthday bash in Augusta, Georgia. And then I played with him just a few months before he passed away in September of 06 at the Hollywood Bowl. He sang with a big band that I put together. It was James Brown's first ever jazz concert. He sang all of the music from, unfortunately, a pretty obscure record called Soul on Top that he did with Oliver Nelson and Louis Belson and Ray Brown's. It's a really great album, so we performed that album live. Once I started taking double bass lessons in middle school, and you know, I'm learning how to read music, I'm playing in the orchestra, almost simultaneously, my great uncle, he was so excited that I was taking double bass lessons, he says, hey, I want you to come over. I got some records I'm gonna play for you. And then that's when he turned me on to jazz. It's not that I didn't like jazz, but, you know, I mean, I was 11, you know. So I heard it, and I was like, yeah, okay, it's not bad, but, you know, give me my Michael. Give me my Prince. Give me my James, you know. The first record he played for me that really got me, like, good was Jazz at Massey Hall with Charlie Parker, Dizzy Gillespie, Bud Powell, Charles Mingus, and Max Roach. I just remember hearing it for the first time, and I just... like, wow, what is this music? I'm looking at the liner notes on the back and saw that the record was recorded in 1953. And when I heard the record, it was 1983. So I'm thinking 30 years ago, this energetic, happy music was going on. I don't see why more jazz music probably doesn't feel the same way. So then I dove into jazz head first. So that moment, and I think the second big moment was when I met Wynton Marsalis. And certainly by teenager standards, musical teenager standards, he was a household name already. He had already won a multiple Grammys, was very well respected, not just musically, but also socially. He came to do a workshop at University of the Arts. And I with a bunch of other students, we went and saw his workshop. yes, I still love the electric bass, I still love funk, I still love fusion, and I will play that, but my focus will now be on acoustic, traditional, straight-ahead jazz. And a lot of that was because of meeting and hooking up with Wynton, who really was proactive about being a mentor and a big brother. Yeah, that was very important for me. I think with any musician, once they get to a certain point in their development, there's not a lot of conscious thought going on anymore. I always think that no matter what style of music I'm playing, people know what my roots are. You know, I think people hear me play and they're thinking, okay, I can hear James Brown in there, even though it's a jazz song. Yeah, I hear Ray Brown in there. You know, I hear the Count Basie Orchestra. I hear Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers circa 1959. You know, I think people can hear what my roots are. Whatever I'm doing, whatever kind of music it is, as long as I have my bass in my hand, that's what I'm most comfortable with.
Christian McBride and his trio, Christian Sands at the piano, with Jerome Jennings drumming.